It's good to see everybody here and online. I'm going to discuss nutrition and NTM. And specifically, there are just five topics I had to limit somehow. So I asked the doctors what they thought would be important to go over. And we picked, first of all, starting with why nutrition is important and why it deserves a little respect. So I think I want to try and explain this because I feel like if people understand that, then they'll be able to make better food choices by themselves. We'll look at diet trends and which ones may or may not be good for you. Oftentimes we're telling people, look, this is what might be what you might hear in the media, but consider your own situation before you decide what to do. We'll go over some brief nutrition guidelines for everything. So that's calories, carbohydrate, fat, and protein. And every time someone tells me they've seen me talk, they say, oh, all I learned was that I should eat enough protein. And so I want to try and actually work against that because you need more than just protein. You need calories, you need carbohydrates, you need fats too. So I hope you walk away from this thinking that you need everything and not just protein. And then if you are really having trouble with weight, or if you're having trouble meeting the nutrition guidelines, we're going to talk about what you can do for a little extra help, specifically appetite stimulants, because a lot of times people come here and they might be struggling, but their local providers don't know what to do. So we're going to go over appetite stimulants so you might know what to expect from us in terms of a recommendation. And then I want to give you specifics so you can go back home and talk to your own provider and be able to suggest some things. We'll also talk about tube feeding because for some people that is really an important thing to consider. And then I'll touch on dietary supplements and I'll try and make a case for a sensible approach to dietary supplements. Okay, so let's start with the importance of nutrition and why it deserves a little R-E-S-P-E-C-T, just a little bit. So the first reason is that good nutrition gives you strong immunity. What do we mean by this? Well, your immune system or our immune systems are constantly working to protect our body from or against infection, disease, and even injury. It relies on an adequate supply of nutrients, including proteins, carbohydrates, fats, all of your calorie-containing nutrients, just to do its basic functions and also to ramp up activity when needed. It's well known that malnutrition, which means could mean inadequate calories just in and of itself, or it could be inadequate protein, even in the context of adequate calories, and deficiencies in one or more essential minerals or vitamins will weaken your immune system. So there's a direct connection, and I want to look at this a little more closely. So you can see the top of this, I just can't, but let's look at the overview of the immune system. So just briefly, in your body, there are organs and tissues and cells that make up your immune system. You can see the organs and tissues in the human on this slide. This slide also highlights the white blood cells, which are your body's immune cells. So these are your fighters. And they're made inside the bone marrow. They travel through the body in the blood and the lymph. And there are several different types. And so this slide shows some of the several types. And I want to emphasize that all of these cells require thousands of proteins for their structures and their function. So for them to be, for them to exist, for them to be built, there needs to be thousands of proteins on board for them to function. So antibodies, for instance, are proteins. Enzymes, which catalyze most of the reactions in all of the cells of our body, they are proteins. So the protein you eat goes into your fighter cells. Similarly, carbohydrates are vital to the structure and function of all of your immune cells. So how exactly does that work? Well, you could look just inside the nucleus of the cells. There's DNA there, there's RNA there. The backbone of our genetic material consists of a sugar phosphate, and that sugar is made from glucose. Sugar, And everyone thinks added sugar is bad, and you can argue one way or another, but sugar is the basis for a lot of the structure of our immune cells. Additionally, carbohydrate is what fuels our cells. And so what does that mean? So our cells have to do work. They have to travel from different place to place. They have to engulf the bad organisms that are causing disease and break them down. They have a lot of work to do on a daily basis. That work comes from the breakdown of glucose or sugar or carbohydrate. Carbohydrate is the main fuel of our immune system, of our body. So the carbohydrates you eat are fueling the work that your immune system's doing. And then fats are also important. They're greasy kind of molecules, and they are important in, again, the structure of all of our immune cells. All of the cell membranes rely on fat for function. Fat is also important in all the signaling molecules that our immune system uses to talk to itself and coordinate its efforts. And fat is also another long-term storage compound so that your cells can use fat to do work if it runs out of carbohydrate, for example. As just a quick overview, there are three levels of defense for our immune system. One is just the basic barriers, as you can see, skin, our stomach, the microbiome in our gut. And then most people have heard of like the innate immune system and the acquired. The innate system is our general, non-specific, very quick response to a disease-causing organism. So you'll see certain white blood cells that are involved in that response. The acquired immune system is the very specific response of our immune system where it kind of learns a lot about the particular disease-causing organism and it develops antibodies that are specific to that particular organism and it creates a lot of them, ramps up. And then over time, it will remember the bad bugs so that if it comes into contact again with the bad bugs, it can respond quickly, maybe more quickly the second time. And here again, your white blood cells are all very important. I'm going to go over just briefly three key features of the immune system because we talk a lot about inflammation. So inflammation is one of the key features of both your innate and your acquired immune system. So if you have a mycobacteria or any other disease-causing organism that comes into you, your body is going to recognize it and kind of send out an SOS or like a 911 signal, like, whoa, this isn't good, this is bad, we need to do something about it. And it causes inflammation, which essentially is this healing response that gets all of our white blood cells to the right spot to do the right things. And inflammation involves a lot of signaling, a lot of messaging. And those messengers are sometimes called, or what we call, pro-inflammatory cytokines. The cytokines are an important part of the inflammatory process that will affect or can affect your nutritional status. So I'll bring them up again. This slide also, just as an aside, shows how certain fats, the omega-3 fats, EPA and DHA, can actually help control the inflammatory response so that it doesn't get out of control. There's also another feature of our immune system is the oxidative burst. So this is when, say, neutrophils right away go to a disease-causing organism, shown here in green, engulf it and try and kill it with really reactive species like these oxygen species here. And what you'll see is that a lot of micronutrients are required to help with controlling that response and keeping the immune system in check. And then lastly, there's proliferation. So especially your T cells and your B cells are kind of involved in the ramping up of our immune response in the acquired immune response. And you'll see that it's making a lot of antibodies to work for you. And just to bottom line here, what you eat, your protein, your carbohydrate, your fats directly translates into how big of an army that you can create and keep creating because our bodies are regenerating immune cells. I read before yesterday as I was looking through this, the Cleveland Clinic says that our bodies will they'll turn over about 100 billion white blood cells in a short period of time. That is 10 times the entire population of the world in a very rapid period of time. So your immune system is in overdrive when it's active. And if you are acutely sick, as many of you have been, or if you are chronically ill, your immune system gets no rest for long periods of time. So you need to eat in order to fuel this system. You are what you eat, and your immune system is as strong, in my opinion, as what you eat and how much you're eating. Okay, so secondly, good nutrition also combats wasting. And this is a negative term, but this is how we see it. So wasting essentially is becoming thin, weak, fragile. It's losing your lean body mass, which is muscle, but it's more than just muscle. It's also your bones. It's your tendons. It's your ligaments. It's your organs. And so we don't want wasting. However, NTM, like tuberculosis, is a consumptive condition. So it can literally consume you. And the way this happens is through inflammation. So as I mentioned, inflammation is a key feature of the immune system. All of you have had varying degrees of it at various times. Sometimes it can be so significant that we can measure it in blood work. There are several biomarkers in your blood for inflammation, and we can see sometimes how high it is. But I would make the argument that even if we can't detect it on your blood work, if you're sick or if you're fighting a chronic infection, you probably have some degree of this process going on, even in a mild form. So what's happening during inflammation? Those pro-inflammatory cytokines are causing changes in your body chemistry. Your resting energy expenditure goes up. That's how many calories you burn in the course of a day just at rest. It's higher. That means you're burning more calories, even if you are not moving, even if you are bedridden. A lot of times people will say to me, but I don't do anything, so I don't burn any calories. You burn plenty of calories because you're fighting the infection. Also, these pro-inflammatory cytokines will go to your lean body mass and start breaking it down, because they need that energy and those building blocks to make the immune response. It's just a change. It kind of happens without your permission. and what you can see is a loss of muscle mass and also a loss of function. So you can lose strength. This can happen rapidly, can also, especially if you're sick, if you're hospitalized, particularly if you unfortunately happen to be in the intensive care unit, you're highly inflamed, highly sick, you could have very rapid breakdown of your muscle, or it can happen slowly if you're just chronically fighting this, which most of you are. And this is primarily cytokine mediated, but that's what your immune system is doing. It's inflaming, it's trying to heal you, it's throwing off these cytokines, it's telling your body to change its body chemistry. And so to some degree, it's working against you even as it's trying to heal you. There are just unfortunate trade-offs when it's trying to ramp up your immune system, that is. We also see increased rates of protein excretion, negative nitrogen balance, and we see that your appetite is suppressed. And again, that's cytokine mediated. It is because of changes in your body chemistry that you may not want to eat. So if you feel like you no longer want to eat the foods you once loved, or they don't taste the same, or if you feel like you start eating and you're like really full after eating a toddler-sized portion of food, which I see all the time, that's not because you're getting older necessarily, or it's not something that you should just accept. You should realize that this inflammatory wasting process could very well be happening, and you're at risk for losing all of your functional lean body mass. Not all of it, but too much of it. It's very hard to get that back once you've lost it. And it doesn't come back as lean body mass usually. It comes back right on your tummy or on your hips or wherever you don't want it. So this is what you're fighting against. And we want you to put up a strong fight. And that's where nutrition really comes into play. Now, I will say your medications are really going to help suppress the inflammation and the infection. And so it's really important to get the right medications on board. But then on top of that, you need to make sure that your food is also your medicine. Okay, so the point at which the severity or the persistence of inflammation results in a decrease in your lean body mass associated with functional impairment is what is called disease-related malnutrition. And I want to show you this next slide related to disease-related malnutrition because I want it to have an impact. So this is a theoretical graph that shows changes in your lean body mass over time when you have acute infection or inflammation and chronic infection or inflammation. So look at the red solid line. What that shows is if you are acutely sick, you have a flare, you're really not doing well, maybe you're in the hospital, your lean body mass can go from its baseline of say 100% down to 60% in 1 month. In 4 weeks, you can lose a tremendous amount of your lean body mass. That's your muscle mass, again, your bones, your tendons, your ligaments, your organs, your heart, things that you don't want to lose. You're not, if you're very acutely ill, if you're really hospitalized and you're seriously sick, you're not going to use, so your body's not going to tap your fat sources. It's going to tap your lean body mass. And that's unfortunate, but that's what our body's doing to try and protect us. So when women tell me they're happy they've lost weight, I'm thinking this is not anything to be happy about. What you should try and do, and let me say, if you are carrying extra weight and happy that you're losing weight, I also tell people when you're sick is not the time to lose weight because you're losing lean body mass. Get through the sickness and then focus on not eating as much of whatever it is that you know you might be overdoing or eating less, but not when you're sick. So to point out other things on here, the red dotted line is what will happen, something good, if you eat food, if you have nutrition support on board. And what you can see is there's a mitigating effect. So if you are fed properly in this setting of acute illness, you're not going to have as great of a loss. Then the blue line is more of what happens chronically. So the kind of the larger dashes that are the same length, that's what could happen theoretically if you are fighting a chronic illness over time. You can see there's still significant loss over the course of 3-6 months or more. There's significant loss of your lean body mass, but it's not as severe as it is if you're acute. And you can see that if you have proper nutrition, it's mitigated. So every time I'm talking to someone, this is in the back of my mind. We don't want you losing weight. And we also want you getting treated appropriately as quickly as possible. But this is why we want you eating more, not less, of everything: calories, carbohydrate, protein, fat. Okay. And then thirdly, we know that low BMIs are associated with poor outcomes. And conversely, better nutrition will lead to, in theory, better weight and better BMIs and more favorable outcomes. So just to explain what BMI is, it is an index. It's known as the body mass index. It's a comparison between your body weight and your height. And I just used a typical female that I would see here in clinic. She's 5'4", and she's 100 pounds. And she is happy at 100 pounds. She fits into her clothes better. She feels better. A lot of times these people have great energy still. They feel strong. They feel good. Unfortunately, her BMI is under that cutoff of 18.5. We know that there seems to be good evidence that a BMI less than 18.5 is associated with less favorable outcomes. What does that mean? It means your disease might be more likely to progress. It means you might have more lung segments that are affected by disease. It means there might be a higher risk of death due to NTM. And anecdotally, we think these particular people don't respond as well to antibiotics. So all of this is bad news. And from our perspective, fitting into some tinier clothing, just the benefits of that just in no way compares to the negatives of this. And we try and make that case. Now, I will say we're not sure if we're not sure what is causing what. So is the low weight causing the worst disease, or is it just that people who have worse disease end up suffering and they end up being underweight? We don't know, but we know they're linked. And we believe that increasing your weight will increase the strength of your immunity, because we understand how your immune system works and what it relies on. And I've tried to show that to you here today. We understand that your immune system needs a tremendous amount of resources in order to work effectively. Okay, so in terms of goal weights, when I meet with people, the average woman is 5'4 or 5'5. I want her above 110 pounds. And in fact, I'm still not totally satisfied with that, because I don't think that's enough of a reserve. And there is also some evidence in other pulmonary disease like COPD to suggest that if your BMI is closer to 21, you do even better. You live longer, you have a better quality of life, you don't get sick as often. When you get sick, you recover more quickly. So I prefer you to be closer to 125, if at all possible. And sometimes people will say to me, but I've never been that heavy. And I get that, but what I'm going to try and barter with, or I'm going to try and negotiate getting an extra 5 pounds, or can we get another, you know, 5 or 10 pounds? And so that becomes our goal. If you've never been the body weight that we want you to be, can we get closer to it? Because we think you'll be stronger for it. Okay, wait, I think I'm going to say one other thing here. I guess there's men too, and I do see men in clinic. And so if you run the calculations for an average 5'9 or 5'10 man, it would mean we want your weight to be above 130. But there's a caveat here. 130 for a 5'9 or 5'10 man is very thin. It's very underweight. I wouldn't recommend that, honestly, for anybody. BMI becomes problematic with the genders, and in men, as you get taller, tall men can look like they have a normal BMI, but really be far underweight and far under their ideal body weight. So I'm putting the numbers up here, but I really want men to be closer to the 145, 150 or beyond. Okay. So then there is an issue with body image here. Most women that I counsel and most women that I know have a cultural preference for being thin. And so you have to check this. Check in with yourself. Ask yourself if this is something you prefer. Ask yourself if you like yourself the way you are, which may be thinner than, say, some people are telling you you should be for your health now that you have NTM. And I think what we want to try and work against are some of these body images, because when you have a chronic infection or a chronic disease, it doesn't serve you. And you have to ask yourself if maintaining a certain thinness because of societal norms is really actually helpful to you now that you have NTM. And we're going to make the case that it's probably less helpful for you, even though there may be more wide acceptance of it by yourself and of the society. And I'll also say this, a number of my people that I see, their age range is 55, 60, 65. And my sense is that maybe they've grown up with people like Jackie Kennedy as an icon. And she was this fashion icon in the 60s and sleek and slender and everything else. And again, it's part of the body image. And I think we just have to check that and ask what our preferences are, where they come from, and whether or not they serve us. A lot of women, particularly that I counsel, are afraid of getting fat, because usually the conversation goes, I think you would be healthier, stronger, sleep better, have a better mood if you restored a little bit of weight. And usually I'll get back, but I don't want to get fat. And they also don't want to get fat around their waist. They wouldn't mind gaining just a lot of muscle, but they don't want to put on, I see laughs, because I have this conversation almost every day. And, you know, just last week I had a woman say to me, well, could I gain enough muscle so that my BMI was normal? In other words, I don't want to gain any fat. I just want to gain muscle. And if I do, could I gain enough that I would get my BMI up to 18.5? And the reality is the answer is probably no. At a certain age, it's hard to put on enough muscle and lean body mass. Your body is just not building up like it used to when it was young. That doesn't mean you can't. And with specific dietary recommendations, we can give you the best chance to restore some of that muscle mass and lean body mass. But I'm going to suggest that a lot of it's going to come on your waist, and we want you to embrace that for the greater good of you. We want you to be healthy. We don't necessarily want you to have a washboard stomach. Yeah. And you know, buy the stretchy pants. There's leggings, the new like contemporary pants, they have elastic in them. So, or just, you know, unbutton the waist. I can't tell you how many women I've counseled that are like, my pants are never buttoned. And I'm like, you know, I get it. Just put your sweater over the top. So anyway, I'm getting going off on this because it's a routine conversation that is actually hard to have. It's hard to convince someone that they would benefit by having more more substance to them. But that is what we're going for. Okay, so diet trends come up all the time. So we want to reconsider whether or not they are helpful for you or may not be so helpful. So everything on the left here might be considered healthy diet trends. People are so proud to tell me that they drink a ton of plain water, at least eight ounce glasses of water. A lot of times people meet with me and within 5 minutes they're telling me how many vegetables and fruits they eat. A lot of times people tell me they eat low fat or because of the decades in which we were told that all fat causes heart disease. So most people are on a low fat diet, especially if they have cholesterol concerns or heart health concerns. Low carb is extremely popular, because the average American diet is really high in a lot of not so healthy carbohydrates, added sugars or refined carbs. So a lot of people who have NTM and who are underweight are doing low carb because that's healthy for them. No red meat is common, no dairy, no gluten, no sugar. And what I have on the right are essentially things that we want you to reconsider. Because to be honest, I usually ask people to reconsider every single one of these. Now, and this is a nuanced conversation, which is why I can spend a long time talking to people. But in general, with the hydration issue, we think you can hydrate with less plain water than this. Maybe a liter to a liter and a half a day will hydrate you, even if you're on medications. And we want you to consider hydrating with calorie beverages so you get calories. Even a very heavy duty nutritional supplement, a lot of people know Ensure. So the higher calorie ones have about 1.5 calories per milliliter. They are 70% water by weight. That means you are getting water from those beverages. Same holds true for cow's milk or a dairy free milk that's protein fortified, like soy milk or almond milk that might be protein fortified, or any juice you might drink. So we do want you to hydrate with something that will contain calories and help you if you need to maintain, gain weight or restore some weight to maintain healthy weight. With a lot of fruits and vegetables, that's good as long as you can maintain a healthy weight. You may need to eat fewer vegetables and fruits in order to get more of the heavier meats and animal proteins even, and grains and starches in order to maintain a healthy weight. Low fat, and this is everything's controversial with nutrition, but keep in mind that a Mediterranean diet is up to 40% fat. That's a relatively high fat diet. So you can have a relatively high fat diet, have low cholesterol, and be very heart healthy. Low carb, I've addressed that already, but in general, I'm trying to add healthy carbs into people's diets at every single meal. I'm trying to pick the healthier ones. They'll provide you with nutrients, energy, and they'll spare your body from using protein for whatever it needs. So the carbs may actually help you build muscle in the long run. And so you need those on board. With no red meat, I would argue for an allowance there, maybe a couple times a week, and then go for your chicken, fish, turkey, seafood, eggs, if you'd like. With dairy, again, controversial, but the evidence is supports actually that dairy does not cause mucus. In fact, the evidence shows contrary, that if anything, it might actually be the opposite. Dairy is also not inflammatory in the conventional sense. And we would argue that its benefits outweigh its costs, particularly if you like dairy and digest it well, and it's an easy way for you to get extra calories and nutrition. Gluten, similarly, is not conventionally inflammatory, and we would argue the benefits outweigh the costs. And then have some added sugar just after your dinner. You're going to find a way to get it in, and it's going to be a good way to top off all the rest of your nutrition and what you're eating. Okay, so in terms of nutrition guidelines, we're going to look at calories, carbohydrate, fat, and protein. And there's going to be a similar refrain here, and that is generally add rather than subtract. So put these in your diet rather than take them out. So in general, when you have inflammation and infection, we estimate that your calorie needs are 30% higher than normal. That means you need to you can't just keep eating the way you have always been eating. You need to intentionally eat more, maybe 1.3 times more if you want to be specific about it. But I generally will tell people how you're eating now should be more than how you were eating before you had the infection, particularly if you're acutely ill. Try and eat 1.5 times more, or 1.5 times your usual. General goals are for women, 2,000 calories a day or more, for men, 2,400 calories a day or more. And you don't necessarily have to count, but it's a good, gives you a good frame of reference. So like that one piece of toast that's dry that you eat in the morning for breakfast, that 100 calories just isn't going to cut it. We need to get a lot more at breakfast. So I'm building meals so that your meals are at least 500 calories or more, because there's no way you're going to get to 2,000 or more if you need it and you're not eating enough, particularly if your appetite is down. And this is where blending your protein shakes or possibly using a protein supplement can be helpful. You could drink 4 high calorie supplements of certain types and hit the 2000 calories a day. So they do have their place and time. For protein, again, we're trying to add more protein in rather than subtract. Your estimated protein needs are higher because of all of that work we saw that your immune system was doing. I also give out specific numbers. So I actually request most people consider eating 60 to 90 grams of protein per day, evenly distributed between meals. That's to help you restore lean body mass, to help with your increased needs with infection, and possibly help with bone health and other good things for your health. And that's something that we would look at if we were sitting together, because, you know, 4 ounces of chicken breast, if you had that for lunch today, would be about 30 grams of protein. So one egg is only 6 grams of protein. So most people I counsel are eating one little egg for breakfast, and I'm trying to push them to consider how to do more rather than less. For carbs, same story, eat more, not less. We want you to balance all your meals with good bread, oatmeal, rice, pasta, potatoes, and enjoy dessert. And a lot of people have concerns with blood sugars if they eat carbs. So what I'll just say is this, it's helpful to talk to someone about what your blood sugar concerns are, because in a lot of people, you may just have mild, higher blood sugars that are less of a concern than true diabetes. And you can have I typically talk to people about trying to put their concerns into perspective, because again, eating enough often trumps the minor issue with the blood sugars, but it's helpful to talk to someone who knows what they're doing. So talking to a diabetes educator would be helpful. And I work with that population at our hospital, so I feel like I can have this conversation. In general, in order to mitigate any rise in blood sugars, you can pick more healthful carbs, meaning higher fiber. You can moderate the portions. And then the timing of how you eat your carbs actually helps with the after meal blood sugar spikes. So if you eat carbohydrates with meals that have protein, carbs, fat, and you eat the carbohydrates toward the middle or the end of the meal, you're going to see less of an after meal spike in your blood sugars. And there's evidence to show that it actually lowers A1Cs when you change the timing of your carbohydrates, in addition to picking the right kinds and being careful about portions, but we want them in there. And then with fat, it's the same thing. I mentioned this. You can have a relatively high fat diet and still be very heart healthy. A lot of people are concerned about managing their cholesterol. So we talk about eating the fats that do not raise cholesterol. Those are your unsaturated fats, whether it's from an avocado or any of the liquid oils at room temperature, your fish or seafood, or your nuts and seeds, all of which are also very high in calories, which can be helpful if you're trying to maintain a healthy weight. And then if you are still really struggling, and we see a lot of these people, you should consider some extra measures. So if you have already tried aggressive oral intake, or if you have already tried aggressive supplementation with the highest calorie shakes that you can make or buy, and you're still not maintaining a healthy weight or restoring weight, or you're still not a candidate to be for surgery as a result, there are other things to try. So indications for an appetite stimulant are that you really have no appetite due to the inflammation and the infection, and it's the major barrier to you eating enough. If you really feel profoundly fatigued and you've had a significant decline in your health, and if weight restoration is essential just for you to keep living or for you to be a surgical candidate, if you really need some extra help, these are some agents that we use and consider. And so I want to give you this information, and I'm not going to go through all the specifics, even though they're detailed in my slides, but I want to tell you how we approach this. So in general, we start with mirtazapine. This is an antidepressant. The brand name is Remeron. Why do we start with this? Because not only can it increase your appetite and your weight, but there's a boost in mood. It may help you sleep better. The downside is that some people get really tired and sedate on this. However, we have good luck with this, so I provided the dosing guidelines of where to start and then how to potentially ramp up so that you can get a more of an effect. Occasionally, we will pair mirtazapine with methylphenidate, which some of you may know as Ritalin, which is used to treat attention deficit disorder. This is a central nervous stimulant. By itself, methylphenidate is an appetite suppressant, but together with mirtazapine, it seems to have a synergistic effect and improve both appetite and mood and energy and weight. So you can get this on board. We generally recommend you take it in the morning and lunch so it doesn't interfere with sleep later on. And we have really good luck with this. Some of you may have heard of megestrol, or what's known as megase. Megase is a synthetic progestin. It is also an appetite stimulant. What I put up here is that we tend not to use it first. And Lexicomp actually says don't use an older patient 65 and above because of risk of increased clotting. So that is a downside. Additionally, I've seen people get kind of off balance, dizzy, pass out with it. So it's not necessarily our first choice. And honestly, the effects with this in my experience aren't as dramatic as with mirtazapine. However, having said that, some people actually do really well on megase. And if someone's not responding to mirtazapine and or cannot take it, this can be something that can be tried as long as you're aware of the potential side effects. Marinol or dronabinol, otherwise known as Marinol, is another one. This one is a cannabinoid. It comes from marijuana. That's how what people think of when they think of this. You can buy it at dispensaries in their real form. We don't use this as much because it tends to be too expensive. Insurance, Medicare, Medicaid generally don't cover it, and it's less effective than some of our other options. So this is not necessarily our go-to. However, it is an option out there. So I wanted to put it out there because sometimes you need to go through different options to find one that works. And then finally, in terms of tube feeding, if you really are in a dire situation and you've tried everything, then you should have this conversation and you should consider it. Tube feeding is when we actually surgically put a tube through your abdomen into your stomach or your small intestine, and we feed you with a formula, usually overnight, so you don't have to be tethered during the day and so that you can eat during the day. But this can potentially be a life-saving intervention. And then lastly, and I see Shannon standing up, so I'm going to try and wrap it up. In terms of dietary supplementation, in order to be sensible, I would argue that some dietary supplements are helpful and others are probably too much potential harm or negative consequences with them than benefit. So I generally recommend a daily multivitamin and multimineral that's iron-free. because as we saw, your immune system needs help. And it can be hard, especially if you're not eating adequately, to get that extra help with your micronutrients, your minerals, and your vitamins. So pick an age-appropriate 50-plus multivitamin, multimineral, take it every day. I think calcium and vitamin D are sensible, particularly if you have bone loss or issues with osteopenia or osteoporosis. Vitamin D is sensible also to help with your bone health, but also to help with your immunity. And this is something that we will test for in terms of a deficiency and then recommend repletion. Of the other 100,000 plus supplements that are out there, and there are that many out there, and you have to realize that the market for supplements has inflated to the point where they're not regulated well, and their inherent value is probably questionable because there's so much opportunity in the marketing and sale of the supplements. So I'm highly skeptical, and I'm also not fond of a lot of supplements because most of them haven't been tested for quality or safety or consistency. But of the other ones out there, vitamin C and zinc are not unreasonable to consider for immune boosting qualities. They may help reduce respiratory illness or reduce the duration of it, particularly in people who start low. So if you're already replete, they may not be as helpful. But the problem too with a lot of supplements is they're sold in mega dose quantities that are either potentially harmful or just not useful. So vitamin C, your body will only absorb about 250 milligrams at one time, but it's sold in 1,000, 10,000, huge quantities. And you will just create expensive urine at that point. So, you know, take maybe up to 250 milligrams at one time. And that's fine. That's enough. If you're doing zinc, zinc is frequently sold in 50 milligram doses. That is too much. Our government says that that dose could potentially cause a copper deficiency anemia or GI side effects. So don't take 50 milligrams a day. Take up to 40, but no more. So if you're taking a multi-mineral, a multivitamin, you're going to get some in there. So there's going to be redundancy. So try not to take more than 40 milligrams a day. So maybe get a 10 or 25 milligrams tops of zinc. And with that, I will end. Thank you. And I'll be around at the end for questions.